Okay, thanks very much for that kind introduction. What I'm going to be telling you about today are a set of ideas. They're not proved, it's conjecture. But they were sparked by one paper that has now been cited more than 10,000 times. What that means is 10,000 other scientific papers have referred to this paper that we'll basically be discussing. Now, if you think that each paper takes about maybe 100 hours to produce, we're talking about a set of ideas that has been thought about by people carefully for hundreds of thousands of hours. And I would say, with all of this thought, and probably thousands and thousands of liters of coffee have been consumed at the same time, we now know enough that even if these ideas don't survive exactly in the form that I'll be explaining them to you tonight, they're an interesting set of ideas that will play a role in the future. If I have to introduce one word that sums up what we're going to be talking about tonight, it's unification. So unification is an extremely fertile idea, and I want to explain the simplest kind of unification to give you an idea of what we gain when we unify theories. So the first unification I want to talk about was the one accomplished by Galileo and Newton. And what they realized was the laws of the terrestrial are the same as the laws of the celestial. So what's going on? The laws that we have on Earth are the same as the laws governing what you see in the heavens. Specifically, if an apple falls to the ground, if you've got a tennis ball falling, the way gravity is acting, this is the same way that gravity acts on the moon or the other planets. So you've made a very concrete statement. You can now study apples and tennis balls, study gravity, and once you've done that, you can predict the motion of planets in the solar system, and you can test those laws. And you find out it's true. So what's remarkable about this, you were able to say something very precise. You think the laws that apply on the Earth hold also for planets in space, and you were able to test it. And that's always the basic idea of science. And you gained a lot, because now you don't need to invent new laws for every different place in the universe. You learn that all of these different places in the universe obey the same set of laws. Now that's the simplest unification. Let me show you a slightly more interesting one. This one was due to Einstein, and it's got a bit more of the flavor of the kind of a unification that we're going to be talking about. So Einstein really taught us that there's really novel connections between time and space. So these intricate connections make it useful for us to think about space-time as a single entity. When we do that, what do we learn? Well, there's a couple of remarkable things. So the first thing that we learn is nothing travels faster than the speed of light. So you might wonder where that came from. That came from Einstein's theory of space-time, combining space and time into a single structure. A second remarkable prediction is Einstein predicted that moving clocks will tick more slowly than stationary clocks. Now all of you sitting here today are actually clocks. If I look at you, I can tell you're maybe, I don't know, 32 years old, 38 years old, whatever. That means that since you were born, 38 years have passed, or 32 years have passed. So the chemical reactions that are going on in your body mean that you're a clock. If you get into a spacecraft and you travel at close to the speed of light going away from the Earth, your clock will slow down. That will mean you will start to age more slowly. So all of us sitting here in the orbit, if somebody got into a spacecraft, traveled away from the Earth at close to the speed of light for long enough, made a U-turn and came back, when you got back to Earth, for you, perhaps 1 year has passed. If you've traveled close enough to the speed of light here on Earth, hundreds of years could have passed, and you might be meeting the great-great-great-grandchildren of some of the people sitting here in the orbit tonight. That sounds completely crazy. It sounds like science fiction, but actually it's not. Because you see, we can test it. So you can take a clock and you can speed it up. Now, we can't go anywhere near the speed of light, but we can go fast enough that we can predict a small time difference on that clock that's flown around the Earth. And when you compare the clock that was flown around to a clock that's here on Earth, you find the differences in time are different, and by precisely the amount that Einstein's theory predicted. The last thing that I wanted to point out is that when you think about this new dynamics in the way that Einstein told us to think about things, it's useful to generalize the notion of distance in space, to talk about distances in space-time. So you get a new language to think about physics in terms of. So this is what you should expect for any unification. You get new predictions. Nothing can move faster than light. Moving clocks tick more slowly. And the third thing is you get a nice new language with which to think about the world. So the duality that I want to talk about, or the unification I want to talk about today, comes from string theory, and I'm going to refer to it as a connection between light and gravity. And this is the one that I'd really like to explain to you. So we think two things that previously were not connected, we think that now they're equivalent, and we think that this equivalence is again going to completely revolutionize the way that we think about the world. So what do we mean by gravity? We've got something very specific in mind. What we mean is Einstein's theory of general relativity. So Einstein's theory of gravity. And the basic idea behind Einstein's theory of gravity is that you should no longer think that gravity is a force. There's no such thing as a force of gravity. All that there is a curved space-time geometry. So you replace gravity as a force by a curved space-time geometry. In the next 10 minutes or so, I'm going to try to explain what that means. So the first thing that we have to understand is, what do we mean by geometry? Now, if you did any geometry in high school or later, you will have learned things like the sum of angles inside a triangle adds up to 180 degrees. You might have learned the circumference of a circle is 2 pi times r. All relations of this type you can think of, they're just telling you relationships between lengths and angles. That's what you're being told. But actually, if we think about this figure over here, is this going dim? Okay. Oh, great. So if we think about this figure over here, if you measure that length over there, which is r, and this length over here, which is s, measuring those two lengths, I can work out what that angle is. So I was thinking that I should think about relationships between lengths and angles, but in fact, angles can be boiled down to lengths too. So I can simplify geometry completely to say it's the relationship between lengths. Now, all of the geometry that you've studied so far has been the geometry of flat spaces. When we think about geometry of curved spaces, it's slightly different. So I want to show you something, and I've got a photo of it, just in case you're not able to see it. So what I have here, this is a netball. It was donated to science by my daughter. And what I've drawn on the surface of this netball is a triangle. So I've drawn it there in black. Now, let's take a look at this bottom corner of the triangle, for example. If you look at this bottom corner, you can notice that the edge of the triangle is horizontal. So that's the bottom of the triangle. Whereas this edge of the triangle is vertical. Okay? So if we look at this angle sitting here at the bottom of the triangle, that angle is actually 90 degrees. Everyone happy with that? So there's a 90-degree angle there. Now if I look at this angle over here, I can make exactly the same argument. That's 90 degrees too. And if I look at this angle over here, that's also 90 degrees. 90 plus 90 is 180, plus 90 is 270. So this is an example of a triangle where the angles add up to 270 degrees. And that's what happens when you move into a curved space. When you move into a curved space, all of the formulas that you knew, the sum of angles is 180 degrees for a triangle, the circumference of a circle is 2 pi times the radius, all of those laws change. To do geometry in the new space, what you need to be able to do is measure angles. And that's what Einstein's theory gives you. You need to be able to measure lengths. And that's what Einstein's theory gives you. A way to measure lengths in space-time. Okay? So we can measure lengths, we can do geometry. Good. So that's what we mean by geometry. The next question that I want to ask is, how can we replace forces by geometry? Now, here I've shown you a couple of particles. If I was to take two particles and put them next to each other, if those two particles don't remain at rest but they move away from each other, we would say those two particles are repelling each other. if we have two particles sitting next to each other, and I leave them alone and they move towards each other, we'd say those two particles are attracting each other. If I've got two particles and I leave them alone and they just stay where they are, we would say those two particles are not interacting. So now, let's say I want to figure out if two particles are actually interacting or not. What could I do? So imagine my two fists are particles. I could take these two particles and I could shoot them away from me, moving parallel to each other. If the two particles move away from me and they stay the same distance from each other, these two particles are not interacting with each other. If I shoot them away from me and the two particles come towards each other, I will say these two particles are attracting each other. If I shoot the two particles away from me and they move away from each other, the two particles are repelling each other. Does that sound like a reasonable definition? Okay. So now I want you to think about the following. Again, here's a slide, just in case maybe you can't see it. So I have here another ball. Now, you could imagine even this is the Earth and there's the equator going around. And we take two people that are displaced and we say to both of them, you know, walk due north. So if they're walking due north, they are moving parallel to each other. At least when they start, they're moving parallel. If they keep walking, they will land up at the North Pole. So the distance between them has decreased. So according to the definition that we just gave, we would say there's an attractive force between these two particles. They came closer to each other. But actually, we know the two particles came closer to each other, not because they're attracting each other, but because they're moving on a curved surface of a ball. And in fact, you could realize that this isn't really an interaction between the two particles, because any two objects moving along those two paths will come towards each other, because it's a property of the curved space. Now think about how things accelerate due to gravity. If you drop anything, everything accelerates with precisely the same acceleration. So the logical thing to conclude is that what you're talking about is not a property of the object, but a property of the space that the object is falling through, because all objects fall with the same acceleration. In that way, Einstein was sort of led to the idea that perhaps gravity isn't a force, but gravity is just a curving of our space-time. Our space-time is curved, just like the surface of the ball is curved, so that it looks like particles attract each other, and it looks like there's a force of gravity. So that's the idea. So how are we able to replace the force of gravity by geometry? And the answer is particles move on straight lines which hugged the curved space-time geometry. So you're moving on a curved space-time geometry, that's why it looks like there's a force. Now, you might be worried, if the space is curved, what do we mean by the straight line between two points? Well, what we mean here is the shortest distance between two points. And if you've got a space that's flat, if you think about what a straight line is, there you've got a good notion of a straight line. And you can check that a straight line is also the shortest distance. If you're in a curved space, the saying that you've got the shortest distance between two points is still a well-defined concept. So now, if you've got some idea, that's great. If you were doing this in a course, you would probably, I don't know, do this in about 1 year, okay? So we've just done it in 6 minutes. So that's some kind of an indication. There's a few details that I didn't divulge, okay? But this is basically Einstein's theory summarized. It gives us two pieces of information. First piece of information, if you have mass and energy in the space-time, it'll curve space-time. I'm curving space-time now, so are you, so is the Earth, so is the Sun. So you can calculate how the space-time is curved. And then if you want to know how particles behave, particles will always move on the shortest possible lines. And it's really quite remarkable that you can summarize this theory in such a small space like that. Now, how do we know that this theory is correct? Well, of course, we have to test it against experiment. The experimental test here came from studying Mercury. So I've drawn here the orbit of Mercury, and what happens is, when Mercury goes around the Sun, the orbit doesn't quite close. The orbit keeps shifting a little, as I've shown here. So the ellipse doesn't close, it just fails to close, and it keeps shifting. And we can talk about the perihelion shift of Mercury. So we look at the point say a point over here, and it's slowly shifting as Mercury goes around the Sun, and we can talk about how far does this orbit point shift as Mercury keeps going around. the amount it shifts by is 2 degrees. So remember, there's 360 degrees in a circle. 2 degrees in one century. Okay, so it's a very little shift. Two-thirds of those 2 degrees could be explained just because as Mercury is going around the Sun, the Earth is pulling on Mercury, Mars is pulling on Mercury, all of the other planets are. But one-third of that 2 degrees couldn't be explained in this way. And it didn't matter how you tried to explain it, you couldn't explain it. Einstein calculated what the shift should be with his theory, and what he found was his theory gave you exactly that last one-third of the effect. So he knew he was correct. He wrote to a friend and he said he was in an excited mood for a few days after having discovered this result. He was extremely happy after having discovered it. He had trouble sleeping. Now you can imagine if you've worked on an idea for years and you finally do this calculation and it proves that what you've been doing for the last 10 years is actually perfectly correct. Okay? You cannot get a high like that from anything legal or illegal except from theoretical physics. Okay. So, now we know what we mean by gravitational physics. What we're going to try to describe now is the non-gravitational physics. And let me just be clear what we're talking about. When we talked about gravitational physics, we were talking about the planets going around the Sun. We might be talking about the galaxy. We might be talking about bigger scales, cosmological scales, where each galaxy would be a little dot, and you talk about a fluid of galaxies. So really huge distances. We're now going to change our focus, and when we talk about quantum field theory, we're talking about what happens inside atoms or inside the nucleus. So the tiniest possible lengths that you could imagine. So now we're changing our focus completely. For the gravitational stuff, so the point that I've tried to make is there's no such thing as a force of gravity, it's a curved space-time. Now when we discuss quantum field theory, I'm going to show you in quantum field theory how we think about forces, and it's not in terms of geometry. It's completely different. So apart from gravity, we have four other forces in nature. So what are they? We've got the Higgs force, the strong nuclear force, the weak nuclear force, and the electromagnetic force. And what do we use to describe these forces? Well, we use quantum theory. Now, first of all, let's talk about how we usually think about physics. If I had a tennis ball and I throw a tennis ball at you, you'll watch me release the ball. You'll be able to see how fast the ball is going. It'll curve, and you'll be able to catch the ball. What you're doing when I throw the ball at you is you're predicting where it will be in the future, and you're catching it. And we're used to that idea. If you see me throw it, you know where the ball came from, you know how fast it was going, and you know because of gravity how the ball will curve. And you can catch it. In classical physics, we're used to thinking we can know where a particle is and how fast it's going. A tennis ball is a good example of a particle. And if we know what forces act on our particle, we can say exactly where it will be in the future. When we come to study the laws of the very small, these ideas get revised completely. First of all, according to the quantum theory, so the theory at very small scales, we can't know where a particle is and how fast it's going. Okay? This is not because we're bad at experiments. I am bad at experiments, but it's got nothing to do with that. What it's got to do with is the fact that the idea that a particle is somewhere and has a certain speed, we think that idea is wrong. That's something that we made up and it doesn't exist in nature. Particles don't have definite positions and definite speeds. Now, if you don't know where something's starting from, you don't know how fast it's starting, how fast it's going, how can you tell where it will be in the future? The answer is you can't tell. So the best we can do in this case is to predict what will happen with a certain probability. We can't say with certainty. We can only say with a certain probability, what will you see in the future? And we don't think this is bad because we're bad at doing calculations. We think this is because this is how nature is. You cannot say with certainty what will happen. We think this is the best you can ever do. Maybe that'll change, but we think this is the best you can ever do right now. So with this framework, how do we think about forces? So here's an example. These blue particles that are moving could be, say, electrons. And you can see in the middle here, there's this flash of yellow that is exchanged between the two. Now, the way you should think about this is as follows. Imagine that I was on ice skates, and I've got a really heavy ball. If I throw that heavy ball, when I throw it, I'm going to recoil. So I'll throw the ball, and I'll be pushed backwards. If a colleague of mine catches the ball, when they catch the ball, they'll be pushed backwards. So here is the one particle throwing the ball. When it throws the ball, it is pushed backwards. Here is the second particle catching the ball. And when it catches the ball, it is pushed backwards. So the net result is the two particles appear to repel each other. But the only reason why they appear to be repelling is because they're exchanging a particle. And for all of those four forces that I mentioned, there's a particle that gets exchanged. For the electromagnetic interaction, the snowballs that the two particles throw at each other are photons. For the weak interaction, it's the W plus minus and the Z bosons. So for all of these interactions, we know that there's a particle that is exchanged. So this is completely different to the view of gravity. When we talked about gravity, we said force was due to a curving of the space. Now we're saying force is due to exchanged particles. It's like these two particles, these two particles that repel or attract are throwing snowballs at each other. One throws it, the other one catches it. So when you want to write down quantum field theory, what do you need to specify now? Well, you have to say the types of particles that you have. You have to say their mass, and there's some other properties they have called their spin. You can think of it as the particle spinning. You can never slow it down. It actually spins with some rate, and that's characteristic of the particle. The other thing that you can talk about is how they interact. So that means what kinds of snowballs are you allowed to throw? Electrons can throw photons, but a particle that's not charged can't throw a photon. The other thing that we can talk about is how strongly they interact. So how many photons do they throw? Do they throw a photon, you know, a lot of them, or just every now and again they throw a photon? That's the coupling strength. Once you've specified all of those numbers, you can then go ahead and calculate things. Now, if you look at an electron very carefully, it looks a bit like a bar magnet. So it's got what we call a magnetic moment. If you calculate that, you can calculate that to a huge number of decimal places, and you can compare that to experiment. When you're doing that calculation, you're using precisely this idea that electrons interact by exchanging photons. And when you calculate this out to however many decimal places that you calculated, the theoretical calculation agrees perfectly with the experimental measurement. Of the theories that we know so far, this is the one that we should be the most proud of, because it's the one that agrees with extraordinary accuracy to what you get when you make measurements. Okay, so we now know the two kinds of theories that enter into the equivalence. To get an idea of where the equivalence comes from, you have to ask a certain question. And the question you have to ask is, can we unify general relativity and quantum field theory into a single theory? So here comes the unification question. This is a question that the community that I belong to has been asking now for many years, and I can tell you, we've not been having a good time. When you try to unify these two theories, nothing works. So you calculate certain things that should be small, and when you actually evaluate them, they turn out to be infinite. You calculate probabilities, and they come out negative. So if I say to you, you know, you ask me what chance will it rain today, and I say to you it's 98% chance it'll rain today, for sure you'll take your umbrella. If you say to me what percent chance will it rain today, and I tell you 2%, you'll leave your umbrella at home. If you say to me, what percent chance will it rain today, and I tell you, minus 98, do you take your umbrella or not? Okay? That's a difficult thing to interpret when you get negative probabilities. So anything that we do with this theory seems to give us garbage. Now, if you're getting garbage, usually it means you're doing something silly. And if we think about what we're trying to do, we said gravity acts at scales of the solar system, of the galaxy, of cosmology. And quantum field theory acts at the smallest possible distances. Why are we trying to put these two things together? To convince you that we should put these two things together, I need to think of a question, at least one, for which I need both general relativity and quantum field theory to answer that question. And I can do better than that, because I can think of two questions. The first question is associated with the universe itself. So if we look at the universe, we can see the universe is expanding. Galaxies are moving further and further away from each other. So using Einstein's equations, we can predict what will happen in the future. We could also run the equations backwards and predict what happened at very early times in the universe. And if you run the equations backwards, the galaxies all get closer to each other and crunched up into a tiny little area. So at some point in the distant past, far distant past, you had a huge amount of energy and matter packed into a tiny little region. We're talking about tiny distances, so the laws of quantum mechanics apply. But we're also talking about a lot of mass and energy in that region, so the space-time is highly curved. So that's a situation where you would have to know both general relativity and quantum mechanics, and both theories would be important. The second problem is related to black holes. So before we talk about black holes, let's just talk about holes. So you have a friend, you see him walking on the horizon, he's there, next moment he's not there, you say to yourself, that guy fell into a hole. That's what a black hole is like. Except a black hole is a hole in space-time. This is the worst kind of a hole that there is. Because when you fall into a black hole, you've actually fallen out of the universe. You're never coming back again. Now, black holes have a very interesting property. They have what's called a negative specific heat. If you have a cup of coffee and you put it on the table, and you put your hand close to the cup of coffee, you can feel it's warm. The cup of coffee is giving off heat. The more heat it gives off, the cooler the cup of coffee gets. Black holes don't behave like that. If you have a black hole in space, the black hole will also give off heat. But the more heat it gives off, the hotter it gets. And this is a property, quite generally, of gravitational systems. So, oh, thanks very much. Okay, great. Wonderful. So with a black hole, the more energy it gives off, the hotter it gets. And this is just like stars. As stars burn, they give off light, and as they give off light, they get hotter and hotter and hotter. So it's a general property of gravitational systems. Our black hole, as it gives off energy, it keeps getting smaller and hotter. So in the end, we're talking about a very small black hole. So we have to use quantum mechanics. But there's a lot of energy because it's very hot. So it curves space-time a lot. And that's another situation where we'd need to have both general relativity and quantum mechanics. So we have to search seriously for this theory. And there is a way of doing it. And in fact, this is where string theory comes in. So what is string theory? We give up the idea that particles are points. And we start to think that particles are little loops of string. That piece of string there is fundamental. You can't break it into smaller pieces. That's as small as it gets. Okay? So that's what we mean by a fundamental string. It is the basic unit. There's no unit smaller than that. Now this probably looks like not a very dramatic change. Before particles were points, now they're little loops, but actually it makes a huge difference when you've replaced particles by loops. Let's think about other strings, guitar strings, violin strings, strings like that. One thing you can do with a string is you can excite different notes in it. If you've got a point particle and you bump that point particle, it'll start to move. If you bump a string, it'll start to vibrate in a certain way. So strings can sing. And each different way a string can wiggle will correspond to a different particle. So a string wiggling in one way would be an electron. A string wiggling in another way would be a photon. A string wiggling in yet another way could be some other particle. So in quantum field theory, we had to put in all of these different particles by hand, and we had to put in all of their properties separately. With a string, you've just got one piece of fundamental string. You study the ways it can wiggle, and that tells you what particles there are in the theory. And it tells you what the properties of those particles are. So you're not free to specify it anymore. It comes out of the theory. It's a huge unification. So one thing that we can do, well, we know that forces are explained by exchanging particles, so we can study the kinds of particles that can be exchanged. What snowballs can two particles throw at each other? And then we could understand what forces there are. And if you do that calculation, you learn that string theory gives you a picture which is very close to our world. there's gravity, and all of the other non-gravitational forces. So that's quite remarkable. And that's a reason to be excited. Now, this is how strings interact. They can sort of come towards each other and merge and then split again. So compare this to the picture of the point particles. Now, the key thing here is when the point particles interact, there's a specific time that me as an electron, I throw the photon. There's a specific time that that interaction happens. And to specify the theory, I have to talk about what's happening when I'm throwing the photon. I have to say what particles I can throw. I have to say how good I am at throwing snowballs and catching them. So what's my coupling strength? So those are the kinds of parameters I have to specify. With a string theory, it's rather different. So here we have a picture of two strings that are joining to form a bigger string. Now, this string theory diagram has a famous name. Can anybody think, what would you call this diagram if you see it? The pants diagram, okay? That's what that is, okay? So you guys are all, you know, you've got the skills to be a string theorist. Okay, now, let's think about that pants diagram. So, what we have here is a pair of my son's pants or a closed string diagram, depending on how you want to look at it. Now, if I took a pair of scissors and I cut a piece of material out, and I held up that material, you couldn't tell. Did I cut it out here from the bottom of the leg where the string is just moving along? Or did I cut it out here at the crotch where the two strings are joining? And what that means is, when you want to talk about how strings interact, once you've understood the leg of the string, no interaction, you've already understood the crotch where the two strings join. So what that means is, and this is a general fact about string theory, you don't have freedom to tune the way strings interact. The interaction of strings, they interact as they interact, and that's given to you. And remarkably, you find out it looks a lot like the interactions that you see in nature. Because strings are fundamental, you shouldn't be able to tell that they're made of bits. They're not made of bits. And the way that manifests is that the tension of the string should be a new fundamental constant. So when I stretch the string, the tension of it shouldn't change. That sounds like a pretty simple requirement, but it's not. It's a remarkable requirement. In fact, when you stretch strings, you learn a few things. First of all, they can't move in just any spacetime. They can only move in a spacetime that satisfies Einstein's equation. So that's pretty amazing. We didn't put gravity in, gravity came out. So in string theory, gravity is required for the theory to make sense. Whereas in quantum field theory, we weren't able to put gravity in. In the interest of being honest, I should tell you there's also some things that don't quite work. Like one of the things that you learn from the theory, our world we think has got three space dimensions, you know, sideways, forwards and backwards, up and down, as well as time. To get the string to work, it looks like you need 9 space dimensions and 1 time dimension. Okay? But we'll explain that somehow. Next, you might ask, how big is a string? So for sure, it's less than 10 to the minus 18 meters, because that's how far we can measure. But, and we haven't seen them yet, okay? So if you can't measure them directly, you might ask yourself, can we make a good educated guess? So how would you guess how big a string is? Well, if we guess a string is a certain size, then you naturally explain how strong gravity is. And it turns out gravity is a really weak force. So to explain why gravity is so weak, you have to make strings really small. You have to make them 10 to the minus 34 meters. I don't think there's anyone sitting here who can really think about how small that is. So let me try to make a comparison to give you some idea. So I've got here a picture of Mount Everest. Mount Everest is 8,850 meters, so let's just call that 10,000 meters. I've got a proton. A proton is 10 to the minus 15 meters, and then here I've got a string, which is 10 to the minus 34 meters. Now notice the difference between that minus 15 and that 4 is 19, and the distance between that minus 34 and that minus 15 is 19. What that means is, if I take a microscope that doesn't magnify 10 times or 100 times, it magnifies 1. Now write down 19 noughts. So that's the magnification. If I use that magnifying glass to look at a proton will now be the size of Mount Everest. So it's a powerful magnifying glass. If I use that powerful magnifying glass to look at a string will now be the size of a proton. So what that tells you is strings are small. So now we're finally ready to see what is the equivalence. What the equivalence is, it tells us, so we keep trying to put gravity together with quantum field theory into one theory. And the new equivalence that has been discovered is that quantum gravity, so this curving of space-time way of thinking about the force, in D plus one dimension, so D could be some number, if D is 4, for example, quantum gravity in 5 dimensions is the same as a theory without gravity in D dimensions. So this curving of space-time way of viewing the forces that works at a quantum level in 5 dimensions would be the same as this way of thinking about the theory where you throw snowballs in 4 dimensions. So it's some crazy equality between these two different ways of thinking about the forces. And we think we know exactly how it works. So the equivalence is that if you study quantum gravity inside a box, so imagine you've got a box, you can talk about the inside of the box, you can move sideways, up and down inside the box, and you could talk about things happening inside the box. Any question you could ask for the gravitational interaction of these particles inside the box can be turned into a question for a theory that lives on the surface of the box. And the theory that lives on the surface of the box is a non-gravitational theory. It's a theory where you represent the forces by exchanging of these snowballs. Okay? So that's how the equality works. So really quite remarkable. If you think you don't understand it, don't worry, you're not alone. We're still figuring out how this works. We're still figuring out the dictionary. But those 10,000 papers that I was talking about before, this was the initial suggestion, and anyone who wrote those papers would love to prove that that initial suggestion is wrong. If you could show one thing that didn't work in that initial suggestion, and you could show the idea was wrong, that these two theories are not equal, you would immediately become famous. So at this point in time, we really believe that these two theories are equivalent. We have, I would say, overwhelming evidence in favor of the equivalence of the two. There's also something else very important this illustrates. You're often told that if you're stuck with a problem, you should think outside the box. Now, in this case, you would have really made a mistake if you thought outside the box. In this case, you have to think on the box if you want to get the solution. Now, just one other point I wanted to make. So we're talking about quantum gravity inside a box. How do you put gravity inside a box? So this is the curved space-time. And to talk about the geometry of space-time, I said I have to tell you how to measure lengths. So let me show you what it means to have gravity in a box. So this is one of Escher's drawings. You can see these black figures over here are devils, and these white figures over here are angels. And the whole space is made by putting together angels and devils. What does this have to do with what I've been talking about? The following. If you measure the length of any of these angels, so the distance between that point and that point, I need to tell you how long it is. What I'm telling you is every single angel in this picture has exactly the same length. So if the distance between that point and that point is 3 centimeters, the distance between that point and that point is also 3 centimeters. The distance between that point and that point is also 3 centimeters. Now it doesn't look like it's 3 centimeters, but that's just because of the representation that I'm using. But the point is, each of those little angels have exactly the same length, so the space is really packed into the edges of this shape. So that's what it means to have gravity in a box. This would be a space with a constant negative curvature. We would call it an anti-de Sitter space. So what are we using the equivalence for? Well, one of the things that we would like to do, we'd like to calculate the probability that black holes form and then evaporate. That sounds like a difficult question. It is a difficult question. In the gravity theory, we don't even know how to formulate it. But that's the theory where we have the curving geometry. We've got the other theory, the light, where we exchange the photon between the particles. So this theory, where the snowballs are exchanged, this is exactly how we describe light. So using this duality, we can turn this question into another question about light, about these normal quantum field theories. And the calculations using light are much easier. They're much more well-defined. We also still can't do those calculations. But we think that we can make more progress with those calculations than with the original gravity ones. Those look much easier. So that's the hope. And with that thought, I'll end.
Thank you, Robert, and I'm glad you're enjoying your cocktail, finally. so we have time for a few questions. Now, if you'd like to ask a question, because there's only one microphone, please come to the front or sort of try to get to a place where I can reach you. Are there any questions? Yes.
Is the cord long enough? Okay. Hi, Prof. Earlier you mentioned that when you stretch the string, you see some interesting properties. But if it's so small, how do you stretch it?
Okay. So I'm a theoretician. I don't have to actually stretch things. I can just think about stretching things. And when you think about stretching things, it's interesting.
Are there any other questions? Is it possible to come to the front?
Yes.
Hi, Prof. Do we know yet how gravity can interact with little strings across the whole cosmos?
Okay, I would say that string theory is still sort of in its infancy, and I think that we don't really know how string theory applies to the world. But there are toy models where you can set up a string theory and you can answer sort of any questions you want as long as the strings are interacting with each other weakly. And then we can answer all these kinds of questions. But as regards to the role that string theory will play in our world, I would say that we still don't know. Yep.
Okay, we have time for maybe a couple more questions.
Thanks for the talk. And my question is, we have a string theory, and what are the other theories that are trying to explain the unification or any explanation for the whole cosmos and quantum mechanics?
Okay, so as far as unifying the four fundamental forces together with gravity goes, I would say string theory is the only theory trying to directly do that. But there are other theories that are trying to understand gravity at the shorter scale, so quantum gravity. So there's other versions of that. Some of those would include, say, loop quantum gravity. There's other more mathematical formulations, they're called dynamical triangulations. So with loop quantum gravity, you actually take gravitational flux lines, gravitational field lines, you curve them into little loops, those are your basic variables, and you try to work out physics in terms of those variables. So what you're trying to do is gravity as we know it in our world, and you're trying to work out the quantum laws for that gravity. I don't think that that program has met with much success. There are others that still work on it, so obviously they don't agree. And that particular program is not trying to unify the other forces together with gravity. That tries to study gravity on its own. And then there's other theories like this dynamical triangulations, where you actually sum over different universes in some statistical model, and you try to make sense of that and answer certain physical questions. Again, that's trying to study gravity itself and not unify it with other interactions. In my opinion, okay, so I'm sure many people would disagree with me, string theory is the only promising candidate. Yeah.
Another question here.
Hi there, thank you. So in descriptive science, they say there is no darkness without the light. Can you also make sense of that in its opposition, there is no light without the darkness?
No.
All right, maybe time for one last question. You have to come to the front or shout.
Hi. How do we conceptualize the notion of all of these extra spatial dimensions, and then do those have experimentally verifiable implications? And if not, if string theory isn't falsifiable, is it really science?
Okay, good. So, oh, good question. Okay, if string theory is not falsifiable, it's not science. Okay, for sure. Okay, so there's a couple of issues, so let me just go through them. So the first thing is, you said, would these extra dimensions have consequences? And absolutely they would. So we don't see six of these dimensions. So I think it's the most naive way you could think about things. You can curve up the extra six dimensions you don't see into a small space. And when you do that, you do still see the properties of that space appearing. Because when you excite the particle in these extra dimensions, it looks like a new particle in nature. So what we would be able to see, for example, is a certain pattern of particles appearing as you go up in energy. And from that pattern, you would be able to read off the geometry of these extra six dimensions that you've curled up. Another thing you would be able to do, I mean, people have suggested that some of these extra dimensions might not be so small. And then you might see some particles scattering, for example, under some experiment. And when you work out the energy when you started and the energy at the end of the experiment, you find out that some of the energy is missing. And this could have leaked into these extra dimensions. And you can calculate that very explicitly. So it does make predictions. Now, the question of whether string theory is falsifiable or not, people usually challenge string theory from a different point of view. And that point of view is, to make predictions with a theory, you have to know what's called the vacuum state of the theory, sort of the state with no particles. And the claim is, in string theory, there are a huge number of possible vacuum states. A very, very large number. In fact, there's so many possible vacuum states with so many different properties that it doesn't matter what universe you lived in, string theory could explain it. Okay? That would be bad news for the theory. Now, lots of people have latched onto this, and this is a very public thing, and it's reported everywhere. You know what? We don't know of one proper vacuum of string theory that's realistic. This whole landscape of vacua that are meant to exist, that people call this the landscape, I mean, I think there's lots of people who are skeptical about whether that exists or not. I should say, if somebody proves it really exists, and you could explain any universe that you lived in, then string theory really isn't science. And I can tell you, everyone who's doing string theory today, if you can prove the theory is not falsifiable, will not be doing string theory tomorrow. The fact that there's so many people continuing with the theory, it means that they're not convinced at all by these arguments that say string theory is not falsifiable.